back pocket burner. And we're going to go ahead and get started if y'all are ready. So what we're going to go over is we're going to go watch our production video. We're going to show you our product, show you some of the advertising that we use, go over our performance and our goals that we set, go over some reflections, some future business opportunities, what we would do to scale up, and then suggestions that we have for our product, and then suggestions for the class as well. And then we'll take questions all at the end.
All right, here's our production video.
Oh.
So our product is made up of these five pieces here. It's got a lower tray, an upper tray. It's got a lock feature so the trays don't just fall out. And the stove is multi-use. You can use it for backpacking, camping, have friends take it to the beach. You can do whatever you want to do with it. It's under the stove itself weighs under a pound. You can use you can use a variety of fuel sources. So you can use pressurized fuel sources or solidified alcohol or whatever your heart desires. Or you could use these tablets as well. These burn up to for 15 minutes up to like 900 degrees. So you can boil some water pretty quickly with these. Also, the bag that we made is heat resistant. That white piece that you saw being sewn in there is a thermal pad, so you could essentially just use this as an oven mitt. You can grab trays with it, or you can, while the stove is still hot, you can still put it in there. The whole thing cools down in under 3 minutes. It's pretty quick. And we call it the back pocket burner because it actually fits in your back pocket.
Advertisements. So going into this project, we knew the main form of our advertisement was going to be in person and word of mouth. So as soon as our groups were gathered, we kind of figured out who was going to be what part. We wanted to talk to all our parents, our families back here locally and our hometown. So we talked to a bunch of our families, a bunch of friends, close friends of the family, and we kind of got a sense of our forecast of sales. Basically, the people that loved us so much that they would not buy one. I think you guys might have found that out as well. So to reach most of the other market, we actually made several different forms of advertising as well. So we made a Facebook page, Twitter page, and I believe a Tinder account as well. we also made an electronic flyer. We sent out emails.
Nice.
We actually posted a forum. Onto the forum, camping forum on Reddit, just to get the word out. And what actually really helped a lot too was these business cards we make. They shine when you move them in the light, which is pretty cool. And that actually helped us out, like at trade shows when people were interested, we could at least point them in the direction of like, just check out our business card, and be like, oh, okay. So take a look at that. And what really helped us a lot was we made a great effort into putting up a buy online thing. So all we had to do was. Customers had to do was go onto our website, click the store tab, and there was a buy now button, which is linked to one of our PayPal accounts, which really helped us out a lot. So, this is our advertisements. Performance goals. So, we knew 100 was the minimum units we were supposed to make, and we actually set a goal of 120 just to go a little above and beyond. But we, through some hardships and poor quality or failed parts, we made 114 complete units. To break even, our number was 104. We actually sold 107 at this point now, so I think a little of us are walking out with a little $12 profit each. Which is still pretty nice, I guess. I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to Andrew.
On the production goals, we estimated about 17 to 20 hours of CNC time, and that was based on our first couple runs. So as the class progressed, we were able to trim that down to 12 to 13, which is very helpful for our production line. In the tool performance, we struggled a lot working with 304 stainless steel and long slotting functions. We broke a lot of end mills, which was every time we broke one of the main quarter inch end mills, we lost $2 in profit per person. So yeah, we wanted to hit 20 units per tool. Some of the tools went above and beyond that. We had a couple times the CNC machine dropped tools and snapped them, which is a bummer, and that reduced our performance of those tools. But overall, did pretty good on that. So reflecting, one of the kind of looking back on the class, we didn't really reach optimum production until the last days of the class, maybe the last 20 to 30 units. We were really, everything was running smoothly. We weren't breaking tools. We didn't catch tools wearing out before they destroyed product and lost us money. But with that kind of being said, learning by doing is expensive, especially coming out of your own pocket. We really felt that. I thought that was one of the huge benefits of the class is shooting for perfect product every time, because it's not the school paying for your mistakes, it's you. And then hindsight is 20/20. We didn't anticipate a lot of different costs or costs coming late. We just got in the mail a shipping cost from 3 weeks ago. So stuff like that was a bummer. Also, we were debating on material. So if we knew exactly what materials we were going with the first time, we could have bought locally in much more like bulk orders than smaller orders and saved a lot of money that way as well.
So future business opportunities, I think we were all very surprised or pleasantly surprised by the opportunities that were offered to us. So we spoke to someone from the hatchery that I'm sure a lot of you did, and that is always a good option to take this further. Another one is an angel investor who is willing to take on our venture, fund us, and help us move on. I know we sent out an email. We were kind of worried. He set up a domain for us and kind of just took the wheel. And we were at first we're like, we're getting scammed, but turns out this guy really wants to help us out. He is who he says he is, and he's willing to help us move to the next step. So that's one of the options. Another one is pro bono consulting. There have been numerous other IT grads that have come out of this program, and they've been in the same situation, and they think our product can go further. So that is also another avenue that we can follow. Kickstarter. We all know about Kickstarter. That's a good place. One of our competitors actually got started there, and the funding they were looking for was something around $20,000, and they got funded way above that. So that's an avenue that you can pursue. Another one is just reinvesting in continued production. With the cost that we incurred through this course, because we needed in-house processes, our product ended up costing a lot more than it would if we would have outsourced a lot of it. So if our initial investment to do another round of this would not be very much, and it would be very minimal to like time invested and the actual work that we would do.
Alrighty. So as far as scale up goes, if we were to actually take the wheel with this and move on and try and start this company, we would actually make a lot of changes. First of all, we would never see another CNC mill again. Every side would be laser cut, and if we got even bigger scale production, we could stamp it out. It's a lot of upfront costs, but after that, it's like pennies to actually make the product. The bags, we would definitely not be sewing ourselves either. We would go somewhere with competitive pricing for these. And the same thing with the grommets. We could probably do that mechanically or wherever we're getting our competitive pricing from. Our logo, there are a few ways we can go. I know you've all seen we have the sandblasted logo on the front. We could do that mechanically, or another option is just to have everything laser etched and it'd be a little bit more permanent and very quick to do. And then to improve our product, one thing we didn't get really to experiment with was kind of life cycle testing with different thicknesses of metal and different gauges. So we came to what kind of met our needs, what we knew would work, but it'd definitely be fun to see what we could do with the different thicknesses, but more importantly, different materials. Because when you're funding it yourself and you're getting a bunch of 12 by 24 sheets, you can't really experiment with titanium or different types of stainless. And since we were milling it out, 304 was pretty much the easiest stainless for us to mill out. I know like 316 I think has way better heat properties, which when you're dealing with 800 degrees, you want that, but it was not something we wanted to get into because we were limited by the CNC milling. Once again, I'm just going to reiterate, we literally would never ever see that CNC again. Ever.
So some of the suggestions that we had for the class is we would front load the class a little bit more. We would probably have some harder stage gates earlier on. I know we did a lot of shuffling around with our initial product idea, our design, went through a lot of iterations. I think if somebody would have tightened the bolts on us a little bit more, we might have progressed a little bit further and not have been working so much towards the end. Also, the equipment in the lab, the CNC is very old. It uses a floppy drive, and those are very unreliable. So if that could be updated in some way, that would be very helpful. Less distractions. Those something that a lot of people mention, the extra assignments, just uploading things after the fact or doing stuff like that just really adds extra stress. Another thing is flexible in-house processes. The CNC is great. It wouldn't be great for our product, and I think if we were allowed a little bit more flexibility with things like in-house processes, we might be able to turn a bigger profit on, say, our product, for instance, because it's not as relevant.
I'm flexible in, like, you don't have to have as many in-house processes. That would
right,
some relief on that requirement.
Mm-hmm. Or even, and possibly, I know it's a huge investment, having other options for working with this kind of material, possibly.
And another one is a standard process for the CNC time. So we kind of just developed that on the fly. I spoke to other people that graduated previously, and they didn't really have that problem because not so many people were using the CNC. But now that we have had the problem, we should probably develop a little bit of a better solution. So next groups come in, they kind of hit the ground running. Also, more ISAs. That's always useful. Anytime we can get more hours anywhere, that would be really helpful. You don't have to schedule them all for 40-hour work weeks, but just having more available at more spots would really help us all out. Go ahead and the next slide. So I want to take this opportunity to thank my team. It was a pleasure working with all of you. I didn't really have any bones to pick with any of you. I feel like everybody really put in a lot of work, and I'm really thankful that I got to be a part of your team. Thank you.
So I like the idea about more ISAs, but I mean, thinking from Olsen's perspective, it's going to be expensive. Do they do that? Do you think it's necessary to have all three of the ISAs in the lab at one time, sitting on their computers doing nothing? Or do you think that it would be beneficial to have one there that would actually help, maybe not every group at the same time, but not every group needs help at the same time? So I don't think that it was necessary to have them all there.
Great question. The Blueberry name, you might have seen it at the start. We're a blueberry company. That kind of was just our stand-in name at the start. We're just like, well, need a name.
You needed a code, like when you signed up for your team, and there was blueberries.
So it just stuck for a while. So when we go big, we're going to be a blueberry-like company.
Also, we have a marker. It's technically Wild Blue Yonder scented, but it smells like blueberries.
Thank you for that.
I just want to give a shout out. As much as we hated the CNC machine at times, it did hang in there for us. I don't think, other than like a coolant pump breaking, it made it through the glass, and that was impressive on the CNC machine. We kind of punished that.
Does
that be the case? Should we have to like hope that our machines work?
No. It made it.
Yeah.
And, talking to a lot of engineers, when they listen to me talk about how much time we spent on it, they're saying it takes years to get that close to a CNC machine or to have the opportunity. So to have that kind of experience walking away was cool, even as frustrating as trying six different floppy disks to get one that would work.
Does anyone else have a question?
What's
that? It holds a third of a song.
It looks like a toaster.
All right, thank you guys. All right.